following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
Without freedom of the press, no democratic form of government could exist.
We switch you now to London.
I'm standing on a rooftop, looking out over London.
Good night, and good luck.
Good evening from our CBS newsroom in New York.
NBC presents Chet Huntley and David Brinkley.
From ABC, this is World News Tonight. With Peter Jennings in London, Max Robinson in Chicago, and from our desk in Washington, Frank Reynolds.
Good evening. This historic legislation, the telecommunications law, will create many, many high-wage jobs, will create opportunity and better lives for all Americans.
When the press is free, the people of a country are free. When the press is not free, the people of a country are in danger of slavery.
Keeping you informed with information, news, and the views of people making the news. It's the Nicole Sandler Show on NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
I wish I could tell you who sang that, because boy, did she belt it out. It's a parody, obviously, that comes from Now This News. They're on Twitter at Now This News. They do some really funny stuff, and that, what a great parody of stormy weather. I thought we could start off with a bit of humor today, because there's not much humor in the world these days, and we need a few more laughs. Oh, boy. And the lead story, I know there's a lot going on the Russia front. And our old friend Jason Leopold is going to be here today in the second half hour of the show. Jason Leopold these days writing for BuzzFeed News, and he delivered a blockbuster of a story last week on following the money. Money from the Russian embassy being paid out to all kinds of Russian people around the time of the election. But not only that, in years past. So this is not all Trump related. Hopefully, Jason can dumb things down for me a little bit, because I'll be honest with you, as I always am. I don't cover the whole Russia story a lot because I don't think we know a whole lot yet. I think Robert Mueller keeps it all very close to the vest, and there's not a lot of leaking coming out of his organization over there. And so we know what they want us to know, and there's a whole lot we don't know. but Jason has been covering much of it. So hopefully, as I said, he can give us the Russia for Dummies version of what's happening in the world. We'll see. If nothing else, we'll find out the stories that Jason's been working on lately, and he always does great work. But there was big breaking news today out of Michigan, where Judge Aquilina sentenced that pervert, Dr. Larry Nassar. You know what? He's not a doctor anymore. Larry Nassar, the guy who molested all of those young female gymnasts from the U.S. Gymnastics program. And boy, she was brilliant. Listen to this. This is from her sentencing of Nassar.
So I am honoring the agreement. I'm also honoring what's been requested of me. And I want you to know, I'm not good at math. I have a cheat sheet. I'm only a lawyer. I know that you have a lot of education in physics and math, but I have a cheat sheet. It is my privilege on counts 1, 2, 5, 8, 10, and 18 and 24 to sentence you to 40 years. And when I look at my cheat sheet, 40 years, just so you know and you can count it off your calendar, is 480 months. The tail end, because I need to send a message to the parole board in the event somehow God is gracious, and I know he is, and you survive the 60 years in federal court first, and then you start on my 40 years, you've gone off the page here as to what I'm doing. My page only goes to 100 years. Mm-hmm. Sir, I'm giving you 175 years, which is 2,100 months. I've just signed your death warrant.
175 years she gave him. She said, I just signed your death warrant. Now, there's one other part that I want to point out. Speedbird in the chat room said, did Nassar plead guilty or something? I don't remember a trial. Yes, he pleaded guilty, I believe, to all of this, all of these charges of sexual abuse. What he didn't plead guilty to was the possession of child pornography. I think he's appealing that. But the prosecutor in the case pointed out, and I'll point this out anytime possible, and I'm not a journalist. Let me put that very plainly out there. I'm not a journalist. I'm a commentator. I'm just a talk show host with opinions that bases my opinions on facts, and I rely on journalists for those facts. But listen to what the prosecutor said in as she wrapped up her closing statement.
The final takeaway is that we as a society need investigative journalists more than ever. What finally started this reckoning and ended this decades-long cycle of abuse was investigative reporting. Without that first Indianapolis Star story in August of 2016, without the story where Rachel came forward publicly shortly thereafter, he would still be practicing medicine, treating athletes and abusing kids. Let that sink in for a minute. Right now, he would be at his office on Hagedorn and Hannah, not far from this courtroom, in the Michigan State University campus, abusing children, had it not been for the investigative reporters and Rachel, who brought this case.
Mm-hmm.
We know federal law enforcement did not stop him,
nope.
Nor did trainers or coaches or deans or medical supervisors. Victim disclosures to adults didn't stop him. Reporters began the story, and excellent, victim-centered, offender-focused police and prosecutors grabbed the baton and brought us here today.
An investigative journalist at the Indianapolis Star is the one who broke this story wide open. And it wasn't until that was published that this all blew up. Disillusion 73 in the chat room says, I find it interesting, especially here in Pennsylvania, the minimal coverage about this Nassar pig in comparison to the Penn State situation. I saw a lot about that today on Twitter, and that's why I wanted to lead with this, because he was sentenced. Hopefully this is the last time we'll have to hear his name. What a heinous story. Truly despicable. But and I know we mostly cover politics here, but this is a big news story, and I wanted to make sure we got to it. Don't forget, Jason Leopold on the way. We've got Ellen Ratner coming up with a bit more news. But first,
I read the news today. Oh boy.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
According to a report in the Washington Post, the president called the acting FBI director Andrew McCabe into the Oval Office last year and asked him who he voted for in the 2016 election. The Post's Devlin Barrett explains.
So Andrew McCabe is in the Oval Office, we're told, and essentially it's a very touchy time for everyone involved. Andrew McCabe's boss, someone he's very loyal to, Jim Comey, has just been fired by the president. And the president, frankly, has long distrusted and disliked Andrew McCabe, dating back to the election. And what happens, we're told by multiple people, is that the president asks McCabe who he voted for. And McCabe basically ducks the question by saying, I didn't vote in the last election. And then the president offers frankly, a critical commentary of McCabe's wife, who had run in 2015 as a Democrat in a Virginia state election. The root of Donald Trump's distrust of McCabe stems from the fact that McCabe's wife had run as a Democrat and received hundreds of thousands of dollars in campaign contributions from the Political Action Committee of Terry McAuliffe. McAuliffe, as many folks know, is a very close Clinton ally.
Your article also talks about how Andrew McCabe felt about this interaction and how other people within the FBI felt about it when they heard about it.
This is pretty much unheard of, to ask a civil servant or someone you're screening for a government job. It's one of the rules of government workers. It's simply not done. And there have been all sorts of past instances where government officials have gotten in trouble for asking exactly this type of question. So, you know, there's a great deal of frustration has been expressed to me within the FBI about the way Trump talks, not just about Andy McCabe, but to Andy McCabe.
We've now learned that the special counsel's office last week questioned Attorney General Jeff Sessions, marking the first time that Robert Mueller's office interviewed a member of Trump's cabinet. Mueller's office also interviewed former FBI Director James Comey shortly after he was fired in May of 2017. And Mueller reportedly wants to talk to Trump himself about the Comey and Michael Flynn firings. The Washington Post's Josh Dawsey.
President Trump's lawyers have been in touch with Mueller's team on several different issues, but they want to question the president on the firing of Mike Flynn and the firing of Jim Comey. And that the negotiations include whether this part of the interview could be in writing, whether part of the interview would be videotaped, but they want the interview to happen soon. And what it shows is that there's an intensifying focus on the obstruction part of the probe and the president's actions regarding these firings. Separately, we're reporting that they've begun asking witnesses about the repeated efforts to oust Jeff Sessions as the attorney general. We've reported in others there were multiple efforts to get him to resign, a public smear campaign, a lot of pressure from President Trump's allies. And Mueller's team seems interested in knowing why is that so?
Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer appeared on the Rachel Maddow Show Tuesday night to explain his negotiations with Trump and that he has now rescinded an offer on a border wall.
I sat down with President Trump on Friday and offered him quite a bit. He made an offer for a wall. I said, if we do full Dreamers, we'll give you the deal. And he basically agreed. So we were close. Then he pulled out and backed off. So now I've taken the wall off the table because they backed out of that deal. And then he shut the government down. Now, for 2 days, the government was shut down. But all of us in the Democratic caucus, not just the moderates, but the liberals as well, came to the view that if we carried it on much longer, two things would happen. A, no one would budge. The public would lose support of the shutdown. The public does not like shutdowns. And we'd actually lose support for Dreamers, too, because people love the Dreamers but don't want the government shut down for it. So we cut the best deal that we could. And it's more than just a vague promise. McConnell said on the floor, and I realize sometimes he's broken his word before, but he said on the floor, we will definitely get a vote on February 8th of a bipartisan bill on Dreamers that has my okay. So it will be a very good bill. And the thing about McConnell's promise, he didn't just make it to me. He made it to 10 Republican members of his caucus. A leader is very, very reluctant to break a promise to members of his caucus. So now we have a chance to get 60 votes for Dreamers in the Senate. Now, you say that's not the House. That's correct. But nothing was going to force the House because McConnell refused to put any Dreamer legislation on a so-called must-pass bill. That was our hope when Friday night began and Trump shut the government down.
History of another sort is being made in the Senate, CNN reports.
Tammy Duckworth is about to become the first sitting U.S. senator ever to give birth. The Illinois Democrat announcing she's expecting her second child in April. 9 other women have had babies while serving in Congress, but none were in the Senate. Duckworth says her daughter Abigail is ecstatic to welcome her baby sister home, adding, "As tough as juggling the demands of motherhood and being a senator can be, I'm hardly alone or unique as a working parent." Duckworth is a retired Army Lieutenant Colonel who served as a helicopter pilot in the Iraq War. She was elected to Congress in 2013. She is a double amputee, folks. This is one of the toughest women or men in all of Congress. I got the
news. And that's a bit of what's news for now. I'm Nicole Sandler. If you appreciate these reports and the Nicole Sandler Show, I hope you'll consider a contribution. My work is 100% listener funded, and I can't do it without your help. Find out more at NicoleSandler.com/donate. Well, we should have Ellen Ratner here with a bit more news, although I don't see her calling in. So let me give you a few of the headlines that she sent along. There was one. Let me see if I can't find it, because this is here we go. The mayors, the U.S. Conference of Mayors was supposed to be having a meeting with the president. I have a hard time saying his name, you know, title and name together. It just it's a visceral thing that I don't go there. So anyway, that the president, or Dump himself, that they were supposed to have this meeting today. Let me read you a quote from the U.S. Conference of Mayors President Mitch Landrieu. He said, "Many mayors of both parties were looking forward to visiting the White House today to speak about infrastructure and other issues of pressing importance to the 82% of Americans who call cities home. Unfortunately, the Trump administration's decision to threaten mayors and demonize immigrants yet again and use cities as political props in the process has made this meeting untenable. The U.S. Conference of Mayors is proud to be a bipartisan organization, but an attack on mayors who lead welcoming cities is an attack on everyone in our conference. When the president is prepared to engage in an honest conversation about the future of our shared constituencies, we will be honored to join him. Until that time, mayors of both parties will work together to keep our cities safe, hold this administration accountable to its promises, and protect immigrant communities with or without Washington's help." So I think that was supposed to start at like 3 o'clock. I don't know if some mayors are still meeting with the president or not. I know Mayor Bill de Blasio arrived in D.C. and then said he's not going. A few more stories from Talk Media News. The New York Post says that research from gun control group Every Town for Gun Safety said the Kentucky school shooting was the 10th incident of gunshots fired at U.S. schools so far in 2018, which has only seen 23 days. The White House has not talked about the school shootings, but today they did put out a press release on how the president fights crime. Yeah. Meanwhile, Trudeau from Canada, he put out tweeted out a statement of support to the people of Kentucky but not a word from Trump regarding this latest school shooting. Here's another story. Flynn met with FBI investigators without Trump's knowledge. Michael Flynn, the former national security advisor, met with FBI investigators early last year without the president's knowledge, according to a report from NBC News. Flynn reportedly met with FBI investigators interested in his past correspondent with Russian Ambassador Sergei Kislyak. That meeting was held last January behind closed doors in Flynn's White House office without a lawyer. There's some massive incompetency going on here. White House counsel Don McGahn learned of the meeting from former acting attorney general Sally Yates, according to NBC. Yates reportedly told McGahn that Flynn had lied to Vice President Pence and other administration officials about his communications with Kislyak and other Kremlin officials. Dump is supposed to be leaving for Davos this afternoon after meeting with the mayors, or after not meeting with the mayors, whichever happens or doesn't happen. But the First Lady is not going. Her office cited scheduling issues, but there's speculation that it has to do with what has come out about Trump's relationship with Stormy Daniels. Sorry, I shouldn't even attempt to sing, especially after that great parody where the woman, whose name I don't know, actually could sing. He's expected to ask that attendees invest in the American worker. Yeah, right. White House staff going on this trip or already there include Chief of Staff John Kelly, Secretary of State Rex Tillerson, National Security Advisor H.R. McMaster, Director of National Economic Council Gary Cohn, and the guy without an official title, I guess official son-in-law, Jared Kushner. Why Jared Kushner? Your guess is as good as mine. According to Gary Cohn, the president will use his speech on Friday to get global companies to invest in the U.S. and also to use the corporate tax cuts that Trump made happen. Quote, we're going to the World Economic Forum to share the president's economic story and to tell the world that America is open for business. We want the world to invest in America and create jobs for hardworking Americans. That's such nonsense. That sort of steamrolls into this next story that U.S. tourism is down since Trump took office. I know, shocker, right? Tourism to the United States has dropped during this Trump's time in office, his 1 year in office so far. The result of the decline in tourism has caused $4.6 billion in lost spending and 40,000 jobs, according to NBC News, that cited the latest data from the National Travel and Tourism Office. Travel spending has dropped 3.3%. It also shows a 4% drop in inbound travel. And the U.S. is no longer the world's second most popular destination for foreign travel. Adam Sachs, the president of Tourism Economics, told the New York Times that it's not a reach to say the rhetoric and policies of this administration are affecting sentiment around the world, creating antipathy toward the U.S. and affecting travel behavior. You know, what's interesting is that I thought a year or more now ago, I called for other countries to issue official travel advisories warning their citizens against coming to the United States because of our gun proliferation, because of the number of mass shootings that happen on U.S. soil all the time, and because it's simply not safe to be here. You're a lot safer walking down the street of most European nations, that's for sure, than you are coming to the U.S., if only for the fact that any time you walk down the street in the U.S., you're in danger of getting shot. And the reason I suggested some kind of a travel advisory is to hit us in the wallet, in the tourism wallet, because if it starts costing us money, that's when Washington would pay attention. Well, now Trump is costing us money, and I don't think they're paying attention. Just saying. All right, I'll tell you what we'll do. Since we still haven't heard from Ellen Ratner, we'll take a quick time out. We'll listen to the Green News Report and come back on the other side with Jason Leopold of BuzzFeed News next. Don't listen to the date. Today is Wednesday, January 24th, despite what Brad Friedman and Desi Doyen say here.
It's Tuesday, January 23, 2018.
24th. We have five that are confirmed missing.
Explosion at Oklahoma natural gas rig.
We can't wait
another month.
Treasury Department withholds disaster funds from Puerto Rico. Trump slaps big tariffs on solar panels imported from China. Plus, keeping national parks open during a government shutdown, incredibly idiotic, says former director of national parks.
All of that incredible idiocy and more straight ahead. From BradBlog.com, I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
Stand by for 6 minutes of independent green news, politics, analysis, and snarky comment.
Trump is the only person who watched Deepwater Horizon and cheered for the oil. He's like, come on, Slick, you can do it!
This is your Green News Report. Okay, Desi Doyen, another day, another fossil fuel disaster.
Yes, unfortunately, 5 rig workers are missing in eastern Oklahoma after the natural gas drilling rig they were working on exploded on Monday, destroying the rig and engulfing their entire work site in flames. 20 rig workers were rescued, but in a press conference, Pittsburgh County, Oklahoma emergency manager Kevin Enlow said emergency crews had to be pulled back due to multiple other explosions at the site, where several fuel storage tanks are also located.
We're not trying to put water on it and spread the hazmat, if you will, because there's going to be lots of contaminants on location. So they're not pumping water on it at this time. We're just letting the fire run its course.
The Trump administration on Monday announced it would impose a steep 30% tariff on imported solar panels from China after the U.S. International Trade Commission ruled last year that China had flooded the U.S. market with imported panels. That drove the expansion of solar energy in the United States, but it undercut domestic manufacturers. The U.S. Solar Energy Industries Association warns the new tariffs will raise the cost of solar energy installations and slow the spread of renewable energy, harming the U.S. industry as a whole, because they say the vast majority of the nation's solar jobs are now in installation.
You would think that the solar industry here in the U.S. would be delighted about these tariffs, but A, there already are tariffs on Chinese panels, and B, the industry says it's going to cost as many as 23,000 American jobs.
The Trump administration Department of Homeland Security on Monday also officially waived dozens of environmental regulations in order to speed up construction of Trump's proposed wall on the U.S.-Mexico border.
Of course they did.
The waiver excludes the construction from major laws, including the National Environmental Policy Act, the Endangered Species Act, the Clean Water Act, the National Historic Preservation Act, and the Antiquities Act, among others.
Laws. Who needs them?
The temporary shutdown of the federal government ended on Monday when Senate Democrats joined Republicans to pass temporary stopgap legislation to fund the government for 3 weeks. Now, unlike during past shutdowns, the Trump administration chose to keep national parks open during the short shutdown without park staff or even open bathrooms in a public relations move to avoid angering the public. Former National Park Service Director Jonathan Jarvis, however, called keeping the parks open without staff, quote, incredibly idiotic, and a move that could endanger public safety.
And it's interesting, you know, that the national parks are the first thing that the Republicans always wish to cut, to trim back, to lease out to oil drilling and logging interests. But when it comes to the shutdowns, they don't want to close those parks because they know that with the American people, these national parks are wildly popular.
With the government now reopened, Democratic Senator Ben Cardin of Maryland called for an immediate push for new additional disaster relief funding for Americans still struggling with the record number of billion-dollar extreme weather disasters from last year.
Many of my colleagues have talked about disaster relief. We certainly need to give help to the communities of Texas and Florida, the Puerto Rico, the wildfires of the West. We know that we got to get that done now. We can't wait another month.
Speaking of disaster relief, in Puerto Rico, more than 1 million Americans are still without electricity, more than 4 months after Hurricane Maria hit. However, the Trump administration, Treasury Department, and FEMA have denied funds to the island from a billion-dollar emergency loan that was approved by Congress last year. The agencies are withholding the loan money on technical grounds that Puerto Rico currently has too much cash on hand and is therefore not poor enough to qualify for cash distribution. disbursement of the loan funds for operating expenses.
Incredible.
Also, it's important to note that Texas and Florida received federal grants for their hurricane disaster relief. Only Puerto Rico was saddled with a loan that must be repaid.
Because we all know that Puerto Ricans really aren't real U.S. citizens, right?
At least not in the mind of Donald Trump.
Apparently so. For much more on all of these stories and the ones we couldn't get to today, please check out our website at greennews.bradblog.com. Find us, follow us, and share us worldwide on the Facebooks and the Twitters at Green News Report. I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
And this has been your Green News Report.
I like to be in America. Okay, by me in America. Everything free in America.
For a small fee in America.
These are the sounds of crushed souls. The sounds of despair from former radio personalities languishing in the purgatory of corporate consolidation. These former radio personalities have lost their livelihoods, not because they weren't entertaining or informative, but because they don't meet today's corporate terrestrial broadcast standards of being smelly, overweight douchebags, seething with vein-popping hatred. These radio refugees and their audiences have since migrated to the internet, but their struggle continues as the quest for monetization ensues. Nicole Sandler is leading the way to reestablishing thought-provoking and entertaining radio. And you can help by clicking the donate button on NicoleSandler.com. Donate today, or as much and as often as you can. Dry the tears of listeners by removing the rotting stench of corporate radio. Won't you help?
This is a huge, huge issue.
And we're talking about it. The Nicole Sandler Show on Progressive Voices and NicoleSandler.com.
All right, we are back, and I'm really excited because it's been too long since I've spoken with our next guest. Jason Leopold is a senior investigative reporter for BuzzFeed News and a dear friend who I miss. Hey, Jason Leopold.
Hey, Nicole. Great to be back with you.
Great to have you back. Now, you just last week published this big story on investigators scrutinizing newly uncovered payments by the Russian embassy. It's all following, I guess, following the rubles these days.
Yes.
Yes.
Actually, the dollar. It's the embassies in the U.S. The Russian embassies in the U.S. And it is U.S. Bank, Citibank, where they do all their banking, or who they do their banking with.
You know, I've got to be really honest with you, and that is, with all this the Russia stuff going on, there's so much. I don't know how you do it. I don't know how you keep it straight. I read this article at least twice all the way through, and perused, you know, went back and reread portions of it. And it's so complicated. There's so much stuff, not only with this article that you wrote, but the whole Russia investigation and Mueller and Comey and Flynn and that I have a really hard time keeping it straight. So I'm hoping you can bring it down to my level. So we can
I mean, I certainly will try because I agree with you. There's a lot out there. I should make it clear that, you know, these stories that I have worked on, particularly this last story, you know, it took many months to work on it.
Right.
This was not something that, kind of just put together quickly. And, with all the stories that are published that lay bare what, allegedly is going on behind the scenes with, with Mueller's investigation, with various Trump officials and family members and their, alleged, dealings with Russia. I mean, one thing that I felt that was not being paid attention to was money, following the money. And it became very clear to me that, what is coming out of say, members of Congress and defense attorneys, it's just information about perhaps the scope of the probe. I personally feel that, the information that, that is being reported is not coming. There's no leaks out of out of Robert Mueller.
Right.
None at all. So,
that's another reason why I've backed off. Why I don't, because so much of what we're getting is speculation. You know, things we don't know.
It is, and I think it. And I think that it's just so difficult to tell what is, what is actually happening versus, what perhaps, somebody, some defense attorney may have, may believe is happening, right? So they're passing that information to reporters. But what I wanted to do and what I have been doing along with my colleagues over on the BuzzFeed News Investigations team is just really trying to do more document-based forensic investigation revolving around Russia. So that is what this past story is about. And that certainly was also the story that I published some months back on Paul Manafort. So, a day before Paul Manafort was indicted, I had put together a report. Again, it was based on information I obtained from, obviously, there's anonymous sources there, but it related to money. It related to what exactly, the special counsel is looking at. And, a day after we published the story, Manafort was indicted, and it, every single thing that we reported was what was included in the indictment.
Wow.
So really to kind of understand what they're doing. And, and if anyone recalls Robert Mueller's past as a prosecutor, I believe it was up in, the Bay Area, San Francisco. I mean, he handled a lot of money laundering cases.
Hmm.
And he has a big team that specializes in, kleptocracy, following the money laundering. I mean, they worked on Enron. So, looking at that is something that is clearly very important. Where it leads, I can't tell you.
Right.
I can only tell you what is, what is under suspicion, whether that amounts to, a crime that may involve some sort of collusion. That remains to be seen.
Right.
But that's, that's what is of interest to me now, and certainly in these stories that I've put together with my colleague Anthony Cormier, is it's, it's taking a look at, what has sparked the interest of the Senate Intelligence Committee, and various other congressional committees, because, these committees have actually, I've also obtained the letters, secret letters that they sent out to other government agencies like the Treasury Department, asking for specifically suspicious activity reports. That is on dozens of individuals and businesses, and those include Americans and Russians. And suspicious activity reports are essentially, when a bank, when you're doing business with a bank, or if you've got a number of different transactions that they may see it as suspicious. They may see it as, perhaps signs of money laundering, mm-hmm. or what they call structuring, or if you're depositing, less than, $10,000 in cash, and there's a, that automatically results in a, what's known as a cash transaction report. So they file what's known as SARs to the Treasury's Financial Crimes Unit. And this unit gets between, 4,000 and 7,000 suspicious activity reports per day.
Wow.
And it goes into a database. And it, obviously with a staff that, that they have of a couple of hundred people, they don't look at everything. But what happens is, and this is a unit that also tracks terrorist financing and other financial crimes. But what happens is that if you have a law enforcement agency, such as the FBI or the DEA, even DHS, that is interested in a person or a business, they'll reach out and say, "Do you have any information on, say, Paul Manafort?" Right?
Mm-hmm.
Paul Manafort's any information on his financial transactions. And they'll look into their database and they'll pull it out, or they'll reach out to the bank. And that's certainly what happened, you know, in this case, you know, related to the stories that, you know, that I had recently worked on. Because the Senate is, the Senate Intelligence Committee reached out to the Financial Crimes Unit, gave them a list of names and businesses, and said, we want any suspicious activity reports. So they went into their database, and in another case, they simply reached out to the various banks and said, this is what we need. It's related to, you know, this investigation in the Russia and the presidential election. And so they you know, put this pile of info together and sent it over to the FBI. Again, it's suspicious activity. It's not necessarily evidence of any crime, but it's a lead. And in this case, it shows that, you know, the former Russian ambassador to the U.S., Sergei Kislyak, who's a central figure in this investigation, you know, mm-hmm. Jeff Sessions had met with him, failed to disclose it, Jared Kushner, various other, Michael Flynn, mm-hmm. notoriously.
Right.
And it showed these, you know, odd transactions, such as, you know, getting a large sum of money 10 days after the election that Citibank flagged as suspicious because it didn't fit with his previous banking habits.
Do we know where that came from? I mean, you write that that Sergei Kislyak received a check for $120,000 that was reportedly for payroll. You know that that was there, but do we know who wrote the check?
So that came from the Russian embassy, and what happened was he split the money in half and sent it, you know, $60,000 to an account that he controls in Russia. And Citibank, you know, flagged this as suspicious. It said they, you know, didn't fit with any previous banking behavior. Mm-hmm. His behavior was suspicious, and that goes for a number of other people that we. That we wrote about in there. Right now, we don't know. We don't know what the money was used for. I mean, obviously, the Russian government, who responded, you know, heavy-handed in their response to this story, putting out a very lengthy statement, calling me and my colleague and BuzzFeed News tools of the U.S. security services.
Right.
Which is, I think you know me for quite a while now, Nicole. That might be a surprise to you.
You might be a
FOIA. To learn that I'm a tool of the U.S.
Right.
government.
No, right? We thought you were a FOIA terrorist. Who knew?
Right, exactly. So now I'm in an international, you know, one. But so that's it. I mean, at this point, it's suspicious behavior. And again, you know, even after the inauguration, somebody attempted to withdraw $150,000, you know, from an embassy account, and Citibank flagged it, wouldn't allow that to happen, and flagged it and then reported it. So, you know, this type of behavior, basically, again, it could be nothing. It could turn out to be, you know, there could be an explanation behind it. But in order to learn who is doing business with whom, they, you know, the law enforcement needs that, you know, this is exactly what they need in order to follow the money. You know, was anyone paid off? Were there, if there was, you know, if there is some sort of smoking gun or evidence of real collusion, you know, did money exchange hands? And so, you know, that's why you have this, you know, this, this massive, massive database maintained by Treasury's Financial Crimes Unit that, you know, they can start looking at. It becomes a lead. And so here, you know, we felt that, you know, this was clearly something important to look at. In the case of Paul Manafort, as we reported, you know, the indictment largely revolves around suspicious wire transfers, and which we were, you know, we documented that in our story. And that has been, you know, known to the FBI and the Justice Department for many years. Obviously now, as it relates to the investigation, you know, there may be, it seems very likely that, you know, what they're doing is they're getting him on these sort of, you know, these financial, you know, this kleptocracy, you know, alleged money laundering, and, you know, in order to perhaps obtain information about other things that, you know, relate to collusion. Because what, you know, with Paul Manafort, it doesn't relate to any of that.
No. So Jason Leopold is with us. And the other thing that is kind of confusing to me, we've been focused so much on, you know, how this all relates to Donald Trump and possible collusion with the Russians and all that. But you have a lot of instances in here going back to much further than long before Donald Trump ever decided to run for president. You've got a lot of stuff going on around 2014 as Russia annexed Crimea, checks were being cashed. So
right, exactly. So that's, you know, again, somehow in the context of what is being investigated now, this came up. So when the when Treasury's Financial Crimes Unit reached out to the various banks, and when they started looking for, you know, these suspicious financial transactions in response to a specific request by the FBI, by Congress, related to Russia collusion, this is what showed up. So again, you know, I'm not going to try to oversell it here. It may very well be nothing and just related to, you know, Crimea and exactly what we reported, but it was discovered in the context of, you know, searching for this information on collusion. So, you know, there's still a lot of work, you know, to do, but this is the first step. The first real, you know, step in following the money and seeing where it leads. And that's, you know, that's just classic, you know, the sort of, you know, a classic way in which, you know, the prosecutors and the FBI, who have far more, you know, resources than I do, how they conduct themselves and how they, you know, will start to work here. And I do think in you know, whoever else they're looking at in many of these cases, what, you know, they you know, they will find evidence of, you know, alleged money laundering, or rather they'll find evidence of, you know, what they believe to be money laundering that really probably has nothing to do with, you know, with collusion. But Robert Mueller has a very, very broad mandate. Mm-hmm. So it's not just, you know, he's not just, his investigation is not just focused on, you know, trying to determine whether, you know, the Trump campaign, you know, colluded with Russia. His mandate includes, you know, other crimes that may, you know, have surfaced as a result of his investigation into that.
Right.
So this is where it gets complex, right? And this is why you have so much going on,
right?
And it becomes a little too much to take in.
It does. And then you add to that the fact that the Republicans now, you know, the party of law enforcement. I mean, I always, you know, I thought if there was one party that was aligned with the FBI, it was the Republicans. And now things have turned upside down. It's opposite world, because you've got the Republicans going, you know, calling the FBI now part of the dark state, that stuff that I just can't even conceive of, the deep state. And they're the evil guys, right? And they're out to get Trump because they're all aligned with the Democrats. I mean, nothing makes sense. So I don't understand.
No, it doesn't make sense. And, you know, here's the thing I'll make it very simple. Okay. It's all politicized, right?
Yes.
All of this is politicized. You know, do they really believe that the FBI is, you know, is part of the deep state? No. This is political. Look, I'm a person who, you know, as you know, deals with the FBI very often because I have multiple lawsuits against this agency trying to pry loose records. You know, the FBI has routinely lied in court. And has stated that they don't have records. when I try to, you know, obtain them on a wide range of issues. And in some cases, it relates, you know, to what we're talking about. So I'm not going to sit here and be a, you know, I'm not going to defend the FBI by any means.
Right.
Because I have my own, you know, criticisms about them. But as it relates to what, you know, the Republicans are doing, it's just simply politicized. And so in an effort to discredit the investigation, to discredit, you know, what may result from that investigation, you know, you already have three, what is it, two indictments, one guilty plea, likely, you know, more on the way, perhaps. It's important for them to, you know, discredit it in the eyes of their supporters. And so that's really what it is. I don't believe that, you know, the lawmakers there truly believe that, you know, they're part of the deep state. It's just very important for them to, try to salvage whatever it is they can about, about their own party, because, you know, Mueller is seems to be coming down pretty hard on all of this.
Right. But you would think they'd want to get at the truth. I mean, you would think they'd want to get at what you would think they'd want to get at if Russia was somehow involved in trying to sabotage our elections or influence our elections in one way or another, be it financially or through other means. Yet it seems like at every turn they're trying to discredit the agencies who are working to get at the truth. Say what you want.
Yeah, you would think that they were interested in that. It does not appear that they are. I mean, because at this point now you have, you know, committees such as Chuck Grassley's committee in the Senate, the Judiciary Committee,
right.
You know, essentially turning the tables and investigating the people who were, you know, investigating or conducting opposition research or, you know, about, you
right.
know, the alleged collusion. And, you know, I think that is largely after, you know, after a year, one thing that we don't have, and this is just the reality, Nicole, is that even for the public, we don't have really that much evidence, as, you know, that has been shared, or declassified to really understand what happened. We have an intelligence report that was put together last January that was a declassified version was released that, you know, essentially said, you know, Russia did this. And they also hacked into, you know, the DNC, sent emails over to WikiLeaks, and WikiLeaks released that. And, you know, I think that there's some evidence certainly to back it up. I spoke to the person who was tasked with, you know, going into the DNC and taking a look at that. But, you know, absent that kind of evidence that, you know, that's in the hands of the public, you're stuck with anonymous officials who are making statements and claims. And, you know, who at this point is getting to control the narrative? And look, you know, you're saying that you would think that they want to get to the truth.
Right.
You know, don't forget, this was a party that was ready to sort of welcome in Roy Moore, you know, person
right.
who was so dirty that it just didn't matter, you know. So what they're willing to sacrifice at this point.
And,
you know, in order to remain in control, I think that is really what is happening here. I just don't think that they care.
Right. One of the things that jumped out at me, and I don't, again, because I'm so in over my head in this stuff, it's, you know, my eyes roll back in my head and I'm going, what the hell am I reading here? The thing that jumped out at me that seems like a big deal is the senators on, say, the Intelligence Committee, they want whatever records the Treasury is going to turn over, they want it turned over to them before it goes over to Mueller. It's like, you know, turf war or something.
Right.
Forget about getting at the truth and getting to the bottom of that, what exactly went on and you know, find out what crimes were committed, if any. They want it first before it goes to Mueller. Which I found
right.
really weird.
They want it first, and they made that very clear. That's something that stood out to me, and unfortunately, I couldn't get an answer from either Richard Burr or Mark Warner, the chair and vice chair ranking member of the Intelligence Committee.
Right.
You know, it was frustrating. I spent a week on the Hill last week trying to get some answers out of them, and they simply won't talk. I mean, you know, from a distance, you get to see how these lawmakers are. You know, whether it's on TV or on the floor. Actually trying, you know, bumping up against them is hugely frustrating because they just refuse to speak and, wow. and, or answer questions. You know, it is, how can I describe it? I think that there's so much at stake, you know, for them. Also, I mean, they're putting together their own report,
mm-hmm.
Based on what they've been investigating. And, you know, I mean, look, Robert Mueller was appointed, chosen as special counsel. So the efforts to discredit him, I mean, take a step back. What are they actually discrediting? You know, he was appointed to do a job. He's doing it.
And he was lauded as, you know, the second coming. Like, this is a guy with unimpeachable credentials, background. You know, he served right. as FBI director longer than anybody else. He served under both parties. He's, you know, he's above reproach until they see him getting too close to Trump. And especially their personal financial dealings, and now all of
exactly.
a sudden the Republicans are rushing to give Trump cover and to
yeah.
to demonize Mueller.
Well, a lot of it is also being led by Fox News.
Yes, yes.
You know, I mean, truly, Fox News is leading, you know, the charge at discrediting putting out the narrative about this, you know, about this deep state that exists. And, I particularly, that's why I think it's all noise. I think that is just all noise. And if there is evidence out there, if there's a smoking gun or whether there's, you know, evidence of collusion, it's going to be found and it's going to be revealed, you know, one way or another, despite all of the noise.
Do you think
The noise is a distraction. I truly think it's a distraction.
No, but do you think that we're going to get to the bottom of this? Do you think that Mueller is going to be able to finish his investigation?
Oh, yeah. I think that he will absolutely be able to finish his investigation. And, despite what has been, disseminated in terms of, the attempts to discredit. I think he absolutely will. And, you know, thus far, I certainly have not heard at all that he has not been able to do any part of his, you know, of his job, getting to the bottom of it. Again, it's trying to, you know, turn the public against this, you know, to more or less, you know, in a way, it's also what, you know, Russia was doing. I had a meeting with a law enforcement source some months back. And, you know, this person said to me that really what Russia was trying to do, because they weren't necessarily, you know, in favor of Trump or Hillary Clinton, but mm-hmm. what they were trying to do was just sow chaos here. And I thought that was a really interesting way to sort of describe what was happening, you know, in the lead up to, you know, the election, or election day.
Right.
And in a way, you know, it's exactly what's happening now. There's, you know, this is all chaos, right? They're trying to sow chaos, you know, who to believe, you know, as we discussed, it's, you know, you mentioned at the beginning of the call, it's just, there's so much happening. There's so much to take in. And so, you know, for me personally, as a reporter, you know, I tend to step away from the noise.
Right.
And, because I don't see, you know, they're literally, you know, despite all of that noise, there has not been anything that has, you know, surfaced that said, you know, Robert Mueller, you know, has not been able to do his job. You know, you have Trump tweeting, and that may result in, you know, some morale issues at the FBI, but it has not impacted anyone's ability to, you know, to conduct themselves.
No, and you also, you know, you have Trump proclaiming over and over again that there is no collusion. There's been no collusion. It's proven there's no collusion.
Right.
And then you have his sycophants on the Hill repeating the same thing. Well, we don't have the evidence yet. And as you said earlier, Jason Leopold, Robert Mueller's organization, his committee there, is not leaking. So they
I would say that again. There is nothing coming out of, you know, Robert Mueller's office.
So,
not a thing.
Right.
When you hear that Mueller is doing one thing or another, that comes from, you know, defense attorneys or attorneys that have clients that have been meeting with him or members of Congress.
All right. We're just out of time. This half hour flew by. See, and you
That was quick, Nicole.
That was really quick. Jason Leopold. Yeah. Find him at BuzzfeedNews.com. Thank you, Jason. I really appreciate you bringing it down to my level.
Thanks, Nicole. I'll talk to you soon.
Okay, bye.
Corporate bosses are working up a big surprise for workers. I'll tell you about it today on Hightower's Radio Lowdown. There's a robot in your future, but not one of those cute little labor-saving automatons like a Roomba vacuum cleaner. Far from saving you from doing extra labor, this new wave of robots is being brought into your workplace to rescue corporate bosses from paying you to work for them. Oh, you might think, not my workplace, for I'm not a factory worker. I've got a college degree and I work with my brain. So no contraption doing rote mechanical tasks can take my job. But wait, these are thinking machines implanted with complex neural networks and super-fast algorithmic computers that operate in sync, functioning much like the cluster of specialized cells in the human brain. These brainy bots have a fast-evolving ability to watch, listen, and learn on their own, even able to produce and teach other robots. Not only are they displacing flesh-and-blood workers on factory assembly lines, but millions of them are now being moved into professional, managerial, creative, and other occupations previously assumed to be the secure domains of higher-educated, higher-paid people, maybe even you. To be clear, it's not robots that are taking our jobs, but corporate profiteers. They're creating a robot economy in order to displace you and me with inexpensive machines that don't demand higher wages or health care, don't take sick days or vacations, and don't organize unions, file lawsuits, or vote for pro-worker politicians. It's to be a plutocratic utopia designed by and for the corporate elite, and they're pushing it hard and fast, hoping we the people don't wake up until it's too late. This is Jim Hightower saying, robots are not our enemy. The corporate bosses, bankers, and BSers who own robots are the ones doing this to us. And now is the time for all of us, whom they're about to discard, to rebel against their socially destructive greed.
Need an antidote to the progressive blues? Want some good news about how grassroots folks are rebelling against the corporate powers and winning? Well, here's an easy-to-swallow pill for you, the Hightower Lowdown. Hightower's monthly newsletter will give you the lowdown, even as it lifts you up. It's 4 pages a month, jam-packed with facts you can use, actions you can take, and Jim's own Texas humor, all for only $15 a year. To become a lowdowner, go to HightowerLowdown.org.